Blackstone presents Lovin' the Dead and Gone by Judith Turner-Yamamoto. This book is read by Roger Clark, Cassandra Campbell, Sophie Amoss, and Suzanne Toren. Dedication for my son, Nicholas, without whom there would be no writing. For my father, Lavin, for better, for worse, my most inspiring character. And for my cousin Dan and all the blue hats. Here's one. The past is the only dead thing that smells sweet. Edward Thomas, 1878 to 1917. 1. 1963. Clayton. The day Donald Ray Spencer was killed, he caught 4 catfish. I found them. Right there beside him on the floorboard, wrapped in yesterday's paper. They looked as surprised to be dead as the boy did. He lay there, all slumped over the passenger seat, his left eye staring right back at the fish. I'd come out fishing myself that Friday. Man couldn't work on a spring afternoon like that. Hot, like the first day of summer. The sun made everything green come up looking brighter than you ever remembered. You wanted to sleep. The earth was working so hard. And I didn't know a better place to do that than at the end of a fishing pole. Days like that, Gold Ridge almost deserved its name. The smell of the earth rose up sweet and clean from acres and acres of plowed furrows like something precious forgotten. In a place where farming is everything, it was easy to go blind to the rolling green hills and piney woods that made up this plateau between the Carolina coast and the Appalachian Mountains, to curse the red clay for what's missing instead of praising it for what it's got. I'd been putting in corn all that morning for my daddy. Berta May says I'm a fool to work for him like I do, since I don't get a red cent from what he grows in the fields he still calls his own. And I say, look how cheap he rents me the land I do use. Berta May never looks at what she has, just at what she thinks she ought to have. And that's a big part of what makes her so miserable. It must have been 3 o'clock by the time I got my equipment put up and my dinner ate back at the house. Driving the gravel road, snaking down to Ramsey Lake. The dirt rose behind me in big clouds that showed yellow against the blue sky. The ditches on both sides looked like orange ribbons rolled out in welcome. When I first came around the bend, everything looked fine. I saw Buford's car and Donald Ray's old Chevy parked in front. I remember thinking, I'm not the only man that can't think straight in weather like this. Donald Ray was working third shift. He had his days to kill, and Buford Jones was a little bit of a mental case and didn't do a thing but lay drunk, and he could do that at the lake as well as anywhere else. Then I saw Buford's car had smashed into the back of Donald Ray's. The twisted grill resting in what had been the back seat. Here's 2 dead men, I thought, and that crackerjack day took some kind of turn. I got out, not wanting to look, but knowing I had to, being the one to find them and all. Buford's radiator was still hissing. His car was empty, and he was nowhere around. Probably down in the woods without a scratch on him, hugging a pint, waiting for the whole thing to clear out. There was a complete quiet over things. A fish jumped and then hit the lake with a hollow slap. I watched the circles on the water surface grow and grow until they didn't count as circles anymore. I opened Donald Ray's passenger door, reached for the boy's right wrist where it hung limp over the seat. The flesh was warm but lifeless. And the strange contradiction made my heart pound. Either the boy had just died or the son was playing tricks. I didn't know enough about such things to be able to tell the difference. The boy was 19.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.